My name is Alan Weaver. I spent 12 years of my life getting in and out of jail as a prisoner. But I travelled the road away from crime. Today, I go into prisons as a probation officer, trying to help others avoid the mistakes I made. But this film isn't about me. It's about what can be learned from stories like mine. I suppose there's nothing unusual about my route into crime and criminality. I grew up here in Saltcoats, a small town in Scotland, struggling with the 1970s recession. I don't think any of my teachers expected me to achieve anything. I was just trouble to them. They didn't see the long shadow that my father's violence towards my mother cast over my childhood. Though I hated the way he treated her, I also learned that violence brings a kind of power and control. I took that lesson onto the streets, determined I wasn't going to be a victim, even if that meant being a perpetrator.
I mean, I remember one night in particular, it was a little rival gang from a neighbouring town. We happened to have this kind of scrape, and it was a case of kind of running back and forth at each other. It was kind of typical mid-adolescent kind of gesturing. But by that time, we were hyped up with the alcohol as well. And we managed to get one of these guys, and we chased him and he fell. And I suppose, thinking back, we pounced on the guy like hyenas. And we battered and we beat the guy and then we slashed the guy, and it was really quite seriously injured. And I had kind of mixed emotions about that. I suppose part of me, I felt a shame and a personal kind of revulsion on one level. But I also felt an expectation on me to, it was almost like play a role here, to communicate to the rest of the guys just kind of how hard I was and that I didn't have any mercy for this person as well. So I was, it's almost as if I was in character. And I was getting trapped into that whole kind of hard man image, that whole hard man culture that very much prevails, I suppose, in this part of the world. I wanted a reputation and I wanted to be known as having that reputation. And at that particular time in my life, I wasn't going to aspire to be anything else. But little did I know, that reputation that I was seeking, I was looking to kind of promote, that would be held accountable for that for years to come.
Perhaps unsurprisingly, I get caught up in the criminal justice system.
I first experienced Bellini Prison as a serving prisoner when I was 21 years of age. I don't recall one positive factor relating to that whole imprisonment or that whole Bellini experience. I mean, I've seen people stabbed and slashed and beaten almost to death, near to death, with iron bars within prison. I mean, Bellini then, for me, it was like, I don't know, it's like a human dustbin, if you like, you know. You've run there and it's just all about containment, it's all about trying to kind of just get the head down. There's nothing positive about the whole criminal experience. I was first processed through this very hall as a 50-year-old child. And I remember thinking back, I always remember the smell of the place hit me first. It was like, I don't know, like a smell of disinfectant. And I always remember the noise. There was doors clanging. There was people shouting. And kind of thinking back, I mean, I was kind of a vulnerable 50-year-old child. I was almost kind of traumatised through this experience. You know, a lot of people talk about prison
Is it about reform and rehabilitation? So if I think of my own experience, I mean, my answer to that would be never. Was it educational? I would say definitely. I mean, within this very prison, I learned how to make a weapon from a razor blade and a toothbrush. I was told how to break into specific cars. I was shown how to dismantle like basic shop alarms. I was also involved in gang fights. And at one point, even my face slashed wide open. I mean, this place then, in my experience, it was a crime factory. It had absolutely nothing to do with rehabilitation.
I've served 5 prison sentences, and my last one was 25 years ago. When I met Tony, a young man in his 4th prison term, it was like stepping back in time. Balinny Prison has changed a lot. Tony is on a brand new wing that wasn't even built when I last did time here. But so much else seems to have stayed precisely the same.
So you must see a lot of prisoners come and go here. And, you know, spending time with them as you do you think any of them are really involved or engaged in any sort of, kind of rehabilitation work?
Quite a lot of the boys do the courses and stuff like that, but if I'm honest, if they're honest, they're probably not getting anything out of it, you know what I mean? They're not taking much out of it. They're just doing it to pass the time or whatever. They're not really interested. They do it because they need to do it, you know what I mean? They don't do it because they want to do it. I'm fed up with the jail now, you know what I mean? I'm at a place in my life where I'm getting older. I don't want to be keep coming in and out of jail and not want to be that lifestyle anymore.
I wish Tony nothing but the best, but many ex-prisoners will tell you that the real punishment starts when you actually get released. Sometimes the exit to the prison is a revolving door. Nowhere to go except back inside, over and over again. That has been the case for one of my closest friends. Andy and I grew up together. We offended together. And we did time together 30 years ago. I escaped that life, but Andy still finds himself struggling with the revolving door at the prison gate.
I got in prison last year, and I had a wish, and I got beat up with a couple of boys. So I walked away from the house, and the council classed me as intentional homeless. So I made myself a tent down here. As you can see, it's been trashed. And I'm now living in the back of Tesco's in a wee alcove, but I've got my own quilt and all that.
Why do you think that you get involved in offending? What can it influence you then at that particular stage of your life?
I just felt it was easier for me to make money breaking into somewhere or robbing a place than it was to live a normal life. I can't believe some of the things I've done. I look back to my life now and I think, what gave me that? What right did I have to do some of the things I've done? I've held knives to people's throat and stuff like that, through drink. And yet I've been thinking of doing it today. Do you know what I mean?
Since your release last year,
No. You've
still been involved in offending?
I've been homeless, and one night I got caught breaking into a school just for somebody to sleep.
Right.
And I got found by the janitor and the police, so I got done with housebreaking.
Would you welcome any supports to change your life?
It's a drink and all that. I know there's help there. I can't accept help for some reason. I've got this mindset that I'll let everybody down, eventually. It might sound crazy, but I'm happy the way it is, you know. I'd much rather be homeless and free and be in prison. The longest I've been out until now is about 3 weeks. I committed crime after crime. My ambition is just to live a day at a time. If I survive a day, if I wake up tomorrow, I'll be happy. You know what I mean?
Society's solution for people like Andy is to send them back to prison. But in Britain, around 30% of prisoners are homeless at the time they enter prison, and another 30% lose their housing while they are in prison. Without even a roof over their heads, it's hard to imagine how people can turn their lives around. Remarkably, many ex-prisoners do. Back in the early 80s, my younger brother Jerry and I also did jail time together. Jerry is now one of life's success stories.
I mean, we went into young offenders, went into prison, you come back out to the same circumstances, in the same situation. Unemployment, alcohol issues, stealing, fighting, violence. But as time went on later on, and then you don't want to get involved in it, you want to step back, but sometimes people don't let you do that. Sometimes they want to come back at you. But the last time I was ever in prison, it was for a 110-day remand in Berlin prison. And after that, I got out, we went to London. And that was my last time ever in prison. The anonymity when we went to London was there. And it was good just to be able to go out and walk about, nobody knowing you. Nothing coming your way that you could see as a threat or anything like that. So, I mean, that was good. I felt that really a sort of release, if you like, in that aspect. I had a friend that converted to Christianity while he was actually in prison. He was in Wormwood Scrubs. And that created an interest in me, and his whole life totally changed. And I had a conversion experience to Christianity myself. I became a born-again Christian. And I would say from then that my whole value base changed. My whole belief system changed. And I would say that actually sealed it for me.
Not everyone could find a faith like Jerry. Not everyone would want to. But he didn't just find a new faith. He found a whole new identity for himself. And with that came a new community, just as supportive and close as the gang we once belonged to. Jerry, Andy and I had similar beginnings, but our lives have taken very different directions. These shared beginnings and divergent lives are the subject of a book by two American academics, John Laub and Robert J. Sampson. Their study is a classic and a subject of what criminologists call desistance from crime. Laub and Sampson started by exploring a 1940s Harvard University study of delinquent boys and had the simple but brilliant idea of asking, where are they now? What did their lives turn out like after the study? It turns out almost all of the former delinquents managed to desist from crime, some faster, some slower. I asked Professor Laub, who now works in the US government's National Institute of Justice, to explain how.
These individuals, they were all men, experienced turning points in young adulthood that turned their lives around. And the major turning points that we looked at were stable marriage, stable employment, and for a subset of the men, they had military service. And so these institutional turning points turned their lives around. So despite having very serious disadvantaged backgrounds, difficult childhoods, poor family circumstances, poor school experiences, yet these men were able to reconnect to key institutions, be it family, work, in the military, and turn their lives around and live relatively crime-free for a large portion of their lives. The turning point provided an opportunity to knife off from one's delinquent past. Residential relocation is another way of knifing off, getting married. So that's what I mean by knifing off. So in some sense of physical separation, but in other senses of more of a conceptual or mental separation from one's past delinquency. These men were then placed in situations where there were opportunities for social support, which they didn't have in their prior delinquent past, as well as social monitoring. And that becomes a very important part of the story. And then also, all of these turning points changed routine activities. So their lives, rather than having these unstructured time periods where they were able to affiliate with other similarly unstructured delinquent youth, they were much more structured lives. So they went to work, they had family activities, and so on and so forth. And then finally, the fourth is that these changes provided an opportunity for a identity transformation. So some of the men we interviewed talked about, you know, when I was a teenager and a young adult, I was a hellraiser. Now I'm a family man. And this notion of taking on a new identity becomes very important.
I left the National Institute of Justice feeling optimistic that research can show us a way forward for building criminal justice interventions to support resistance. Yet, on preparing to leave the capital to explore a bit of the other side of America, I was reminded that criminal justice interventions can cut both ways. And there may be no better example of this than America's remarkable experiment with mass incarceration over the past 30 years. Just in the shadow of America's capital is the city of Baltimore, one of America's former urban industrial centres that has been down on its luck in recent decades with huge problems of crime, poverty and drug use. One part of the city I wasn't ready for though is a place called Prison Row, a place that is home to about 12,000 prisoners. Professor Faye Taxman of George Mason University was my guide through one of the strangest and frankly saddest places I have ever seen.
Faye, we're in East Baltimore in a place known as Prison Row, and I've lost count of the number of institutions within a very confined space. Can you talk me through this place?
It's an American icon here. You know, within this area, a couple blocks, we have somewhere on the order of 12 prisons. And the prisons range from a booking center, detention center, all the way to maximum security for the highest security people in the state of Maryland. America's story about prisons, to me, is a story about trying to show visible indicators, symbols of our sense that the only way to deal with crime in our society was to actually build an institution and put people away. And in Baltimore, instead of putting people in the hinterlands, like a lot of states do, moving, you know, the prisons out of the inner city, we moved it into the city to remind people of what could happen. You know, people basically look at this and say, okay, it's part of my lifestyle. You know, I'm just going to defy the norms here and say, I'm just going to go along with this. If I spend a couple years in prison, that's what someone does. And, you know, the loss of hope, the loss of seeing options for people, to me, is sort of what has happened in our system here.
Walking Prison Row, the high walls and razor wire do feel like symbols. Symbols of the massive barriers to positive change that those men and women face when they actually get outside. To find out how on earth you break out of a cage like that, I had to meet some real escapees of America's mass incarceration.
I remember I was in the seventh grade, and this was in 68. I remember I had a math teacher, and he said, well, today I want to tell you, boys and girls, that a great man was killed today. And he talked about Martin Luther King had been assassinated. And I kind of remember, you know, and it seemed like as soon as he said that, I remember hearing the fire engines, and you could see the buildings that were on fire. And right after the riots, they flooded the neighborhoods with the most addictive substance there was heroin. You could buy heroin for a dollar a pill. My brother was the one that gave me drugs, right? And I don't think he knew exactly what it was, because we didn't know, right? And it started as a party, but ended in a nightmare.
Turi and I had experienced using together a lot because we grew up right next door to one another. Turi was one of my role models when we were coming up because he played for high school basketball, and he had a lot of females that was interested in him. And when Turi would suggest things for me to do, I did it. I went to jail in 1979. I still know my DC number like it was, you know, my Social Security, 195350, because I went to jail just that frequently. And you begin to see guards and grow up and talk about their kids, and that they know your name when you walk through the door. Hey, Greg, what you doing back this time? What happened? And I was actually holding a conversation with the guards as if we were friends. And I started thinking to myself, this is no way to live. I knew deep in my heart, even though I was dealing with addiction, I knew that I wasn't the one of those guys that's supposed to do time over and over and over again in prison.
What actually made you change then? Where did you actually stop from the thinking to change that to actually the action? What facilitated that?
He played a big part in it.
I take it you were clean at that time.
And Turi was Turi was clean. Mm-hmm.
Right.
And I'm talking about, he was like a beacon of hope for me when I came home. Because not only was he clean, he was staying clean. And then I could see his attitude was different. His walk was different. The way he treated people was different, because he was somebody that gave me the hope that it happened for him, it could possibly happen for me, because I seen him. He was right there in my life with me.
I wasn't surprised to hear Greg say that he started using heroin because the people he admired were using, like Terry. But I was surprised to hear that resistance can also be contagious, spreading from Terry to Greg, and then beyond. That domino effect makes a lot of sense. Until you're around others who have successfully made that change, it's hard to imagine yourself being able to make it. But can we spread this contagion to support change in prisoners' lives, and perhaps change in the criminal justice system itself? I left America thinking, how can we bottle and package this sort of hope? I asked this question to Bobby Cummins, OBE, co-founder of Unlock, an ex-offender-led charity.
What Unlock is about is about equality, really, for reformed offenders. What it's about is allowing people to leave their past behind, to become a taxpayer rather than a burden on the taxpayer. So to get them in employment, to leave that life behind. And we had employers who said, yeah, we'll employ reformed offenders. You know, and I changed the word from ex-offender charity to a reformed offender charity, because ex-offender is an unknown quantity. And a reformed offender is someone who signed up to leaving crime behind and want to live a crime-free life. And when I used the word reformed offender, more people become sympathetic to my people. And I say my people because they are my people, because I'm one of them. I come from a counsellor, say, Irish family of eight kids, terrible criminal record, and at the age of 16 I was out with a sawn-off shotgun, the youngest person in Britain to be done with a sawn-off. I was involved in organised crime, later went on to rob banks, classed as one of the most dangerous men in Britain at that time, because everyone had labelled me that. That was my job in life. And that is why it's so important for me to give a positive role model in what I do with my life, because then it tells my kids, you can do this. Mm-hmm.
There seems to be something about the nature of giving help that is just as valuable for the person giving it as it is for the one receiving it. But is the justice system ready to allow reformed offenders to make these kind of positive contributions? Some people, like Mark Johnson, the head of a new ex-offender-led organisation called User Voice, argue that the criminal justice system offers few opportunities to ex-offenders to make these kind of positive contributions.
I set User Voice up about 3 years ago, and basically it was to address, for me, a very big problem, and that is, in the third sector, the charity world and within criminal justice, there is very little for ex-offenders, yeah, to actually give back to society. The conversation I've had with young offenders, adults through the estate in all my work, is that we are best placed to help ourselves, to help each other. Young kids say, I want to speak to somebody like me who's walked in my shoes. Then the other thing we don't have is programs that are actually co-produced with offenders, yeah? So criminal justice, from the minute you enter court, is something done to you. It's condemning, yeah? The label that's attached to that, an offender, is a very negative, condemning word, and it sticks with you, and it makes it harder to enter successful living and easier to go back to what you know because nobody accepts you. I often get accused of saying, oh, you know, I'm pandering to the offender needs and stuff. It's not. You know, I've been through a period of rehabilitation myself. I went through 1 year of residential drug treatment, and I'll tell you, I'd rather do 6 months in prison than a week in the treatment centre. I thought that I was in control of my life, and a lot of offenders do. You know, I speak to many in prison. And it took an expert, another ex-offender, to unpick my deluded brain that my lifestyle was actually successful. And they made me inquire about myself, and as a result, my behaviour changed.
Real change is painful. You give up all of your certainties, all the familiar strategies for coping with life. When you strip away that mask, that role, or that character you've been playing, it's like losing an old friend. Not every reformed offender helps in a kind of high-profile, campaigning way that Bobby and Mark do. Others play a different role, supporting others along the road from crime and addiction, by helping with the painful work of personal transformation.
That I didn't set out in life to become a criminal. I didn't set out to become a drug addict. You know, to be quite honest with you, it just happened. In my experience is once I was in that world, you know, it became a normal part of everyday life. My kids started sort of asking, my eldest in particular, we're starting to asking questions like, well, why don't you go to work? Now, that was quite painful to listen to that.
I had a son, a bit like Charlie was saying, his kids. Big factor in the way I had to turn my life around. But the obstacles were heroin and crack and not being able to, having the fear around withdrawing and giving up and living life just with myself.
The fear of coming doing something different was immense, you know, and I'm not talking quite lightly here. I had to go through a process, and it was a painful process as well, believe you me, to admit that I was wrong. For the last 25 years, what I've been doing and how I've been functioning has been wrong. But my changing process was not overnight. You know, it was not overnight, and I think this is where people get confused. A light comes on, and, you know, you admit you're wrong, and then you moved on, you know, to the solution of finding the recovery. My process is not like that. My process is probably, you know, trying to think back, it's been about 5 years, you know, from start to finish.
Going a bit back to what Charlie was just saying about having a good look at yourself, there's a step four that's taking inventory and looking at me, you know, which is not nice, it's uncomfortable, but that's what I need to do to set me free from, say, the bondage of self.
Charlie and Darren said their children inspired them, to take the first step towards building this new cell. In fact, almost all of the ex-offenders I speak to talked about the role of their family and their loved ones somewhere in the background helping them change. But what about those for whom desistance is a lonely process? For whom the road from crime is a lonely one? There was one last ex-offender I wanted to meet. Raymond Lunn is the brains behind two websites, desistance.info and exoffender.info.
Some of the teachers sort of persuaded me to try and get some training done or do some exams. And suddenly, for the first time, I realised I wasn't stupid. I knew I had a brain, I could do something with it. It wasn't like, well, I want to desist from crime or I want to be rehabilitated or anything. It was more about self-improvement. You know, I was challenging what I believed I wasn't or was capable of. And one of the things I did say to the parole board was that when I was released from prison, I would go to college. And I did.
For many desisters, education is a liberation. But Raymond has a different story to tell.
You know, I have sat in front of employers and said, I've got a non-spent conviction for life. I've been done for attempted robbery with imitation firearm. And I can see their own demeanour change. I realised that I was now a second-class citizen. We're presented as a different species, as a subspecies. In the 8 years that I've been disclosing my conviction, I've not got one job. I feel as if I could fall off the cliff at any point. And I'm just worried that at some point there might be a breaking point. And that's what really scares me now.
Remy's story really threw me. He seems to have done everything right, everything he could do, and yet somehow it just hasn't been enough. Professor Stephen Farrell's research has highlighted roadblocks and the road from crime. Like John Laub, Stephen has been involved in a remarkable long-term study, following the same group of probationers over the last 15 years, interviewing them five times and charting their zigzag pathways towards desistance.
Sometimes I ask myself, what are we asking these people to actually desist to? That their lives don't particularly seem very meaningful to them.
Absolutely. I mean, you're quite right. I mean, if people are in those circumstances, then it's very hard to maintain hope under any circumstances. And of course, it's those sorts of things that many people that you'll be talking to won't, in some respects, be able to tell you about, because it's the kind of, it's the wider structure around them. It's the absence of jobs. It's the rubbish housing. It's the fact that their, you know, probation office is 2 miles that way and the drug rehabilitation centre's 4 miles the other way. And so what you have really is you have an interplay between what the individual wants, their desires to stop offending, but then the kind of wider social structure and all of the kind of cultural norms and expectations that we have about people who have committed crime in the past.
So while it's obvious that Raymond has changed, Steve's research makes clear that he needs society to change too. He has rehabilitated himself, but he doesn't feel reintegrated. This worries me, especially because I too now work on the other side of the rehabilitation business. I qualified as a criminal justice social worker in 1995 and have been a probation manager for the last 10 years. So I have to ask, is our justice system making desistance easier or making it more difficult? I put this question to Liz Dixon and Nick Paul of London Probation Trust.
What role do you think the probation officer has got to develop and support that process of desistance?
I think desistance is a bit like raising a child, you know, you need a village. Resistance is a community thing. You need the community, you need work, you need family, you need relationships. So if you're just constantly on the computer, how are you, how do you know there's the Prince's Trust thing out here? How do you know there's a new scheme coming up? So people who stay very office-based and not using the community, then we're not actually doing resistance. We're getting people through, we're ticking the boxes, but we're not actually stopping offending behaviour. What happened from maybe 10, 15 years ago when there was a particular type of model, when the cognitive behavioural model took off, there was a certain arrogance, I think, really, wasn't there, Nick, in terms of feeling that we could change people. And that if we just put them in the right groups and we put them in the right classes, that would get sorted. It was...
And something was thrown out with the bathwater, really. It was something about the fact that they actually de-skilled probation officers, because I think that in the past, probation officers have been very creative in the way they work with individuals. And I use the word individuals because what's tended to come along with that other thing is the word offender, and then everybody's lumped into that great big pot. And that's not what it's about. One of the main things that I've always tried to do is respect people and treat them the way I would like to be treated.
Liz's questions echoed my own. Are we really doing desistance? What would that look like? These were the questions I had put to all of the experts I had met on my journey.
Are there things that we could take from the research on desistance from crime and structure it programmatically in the criminal justice system? And that's a huge challenge, but I think that's one mechanism. But the other thing is that what we have to do is the what works or what doesn't work is a very narrow question, in my view. We need to figure out why it works. What are the underlying mechanisms behind that change in recidivism? And that's where I think we could learn a lot from the desistance literature. Yes, the recidivism rates are high and people go back to prison, but there's also a lot of change within those rates of recidivism. So there are things we know that matter, and this idea of thinking about how we could socially connect offenders back to society is absolutely a crucial question. And what role can the criminal justice system play in that?
My feeling is that we need to really help people, and this is, you know, sort of some of the movement now in terms of the whole desistance is helping people see themselves as not sort of being an outlaw, but being part of the community, being a citizen. And, you know, citizenship is an important principle.
Faye, I admire your commitment and I admire your enthusiasm, but certainly when I look around me here, I know I see is grey stone and barbed wire.
Right.
And words like hope and encouragement, they don't spring to mind for me.
I know it's hard, Alan, but if you look at the states now, we're actually seeing less incarceration. Now, the budget crisis has helped, but there's also these major initiatives in the states right now to reinvent community corrections and to basically try and divert people out of the criminal justice system. And that's what I think is going on here with what we call a justice reinvestment. And it's this major initiative to basically take money that we would have spent on incarceration and put it into communities.
Our underline says that only offenders can stop reoffending, and it's quite a challenging statement to make to a system, because a system that profits, do you know what I mean, from saying that they're experts of dealing with this issue, when actually, no, only the offender can.
You know, I've done 12 years in jail, and it's bullshit. How, you know, what I would like to see is people like ourselves actually try and engage that guy. You know, old girl, it doesn't matter. You know, try and engage that girl to come along to some kind of a group where you can, you know, the primary thing in that group is hope that you can change.
Giving them a bit of identification that, you know what, I know where you're at. Do you know what I mean? That works immense, do you know. Also, like I said, hope. There is. I know a way out, mate. I know a way out. Yeah, it's up to you to do what I suggest. not do as you're told, because an addict will stick his heels in if you say, you do as you're told. But I've got the solution. If you want it, come with me.
Do you think, Steve, that we're really geared up to provide that support and to understand the decision process and where that person is and what kind of support they need to help them move on in life? Are we equipped for that?
I think that one of the challenges which faces the criminal justice system, and I think it's fair to say that there are many branches of the criminal justice system now that are much, much more prepared to start thinking in sort of, if you like, desistance terms rather than about kind of continually sort of focusing on an individual's risk. Of course, the criminal justice system isn't run by academics. Right. It's run by politicians and social workers and probation officers. It's those people who need to buy, yes, if you like, the notion of desistance in order for any of this stuff to have any purchase whatsoever.
The risk aversion that they have in it, this risk that we overmanage, yeah? Risk is the arch enemy to change. You have to allow people to fail as well, because the failure is actually part of the change, and we don't allow that failure. We're so risk averse. The system is very, very dysfunctional. You know what I mean? That is a fact. There's no science to this. If you remove a man's hope, a man or woman's hope, you create and cultivate this ground for extreme behaviour. What's the point in changing when whatever I do, I'm completely defeated by people that don't even know me?
It's a society that is bent on revenge rather than on redemption. We should be saying to these people, OK, you've made the mistake, you've done your jail sentence for that mistake, but the sentence don't end at the jail sentence. That's when it begins. Your sentence begins when you come out of jail. Why should I want to be part of your society that discriminates against me in every corner, in employment, in housing? Why do I want to be in your gang? So I don't like your society because you treat me like rubbish. So I create my own society, and now I'm going to treat you like rubbish. And a society that don't care, right, is a society that you don't care for. I was lucky. I had a good probation officer and a good education officer in prison who said to me, you're worth more than that, and gave me a bit of belief in myself. And also, in a way, being banged up all that time and seeing people that was kind to me, and there was prison officers as well, and people, when I come out, were really supportive of me, and they were just decent people. And I saw the beauty of society and the beauty of those people in society, because my world was an ugly world. You didn't trust no one, we injured each other. It was a violent and terrible dark place I was in, and life meant nothing. But to see these people that was really near, for no other reason than they was nice people, I saw the beauty of society, and I wanted to be part of that beauty. I wanted to be part of that society, not the society I was in.
As a man involved in serious crime in the past, could you maybe tell me now about the Bobby Cummins, the OBE?
It makes me laugh, really, because if I'd have told the Governor of Parkhurst 30 years ago that I'd be meeting the Queen, getting an OBE, I'd be advising the Prime Minister, Deputy Prime Minister and all the other different think tanks I was on, he would have took me over to the hospital wing, introduced me to the psychiatrist, and I would have been on the Wally Juice and severely sectioned and been nutted off. But it really happened to me. And what is important about that is that it shows people, no matter how bad it is, there is hope.
Receiving an OBE, a medal of distinction from the Queen, is about as powerful a symbol of redemption as anyone could imagine. But what about the rest of us, who have no such formal recognition? When are we forgiven?
I committed my last offence, I sent my last conviction, was something like 25 years ago. Now, some people still kind of view me with, apprehension, and they still view me as an ex-offender. And sometimes I wonder, you know, talking about when will I officially become a fully fledged desister, if you like?
The research that we have to date, done by Al Bloomstein and colleagues, shows that the criminal record after a certain period of time, depending upon crime type, it varies, but some of the research shows 3 to 5 years, that criminal record is no longer predictive. And if that's the case, then what you could talk about, and I think you have to have a serious discussion about this with employers. The question should not be, do you have a criminal record or not? It should be, do you have a criminal record? And what was the date of your last contact with the criminal justice system? And if it's at that length of period with that criminal record stale, that's irrelevant. From the standpoint of public perception, I think, again, we have to convince the public, and again, criminology and criminal justice officials haven't done a good job of this. They are us and we are them.
So I can officially call myself a desister?
I think you can.
Thank you.
So Professor Laub says I am officially cleansed, or that I should be. But beyond the formal legal record, what can make reformed ex-offenders feel accepted and feel that there is something called society that is worth belonging to, whose rules are worth following? The violent young man that I was needed to change and needed help changing, but I also needed people to take a chance on me. I needed them to let me leave the label offender behind me. I needed to feel that I belonged. Desistance can be a long and winding road, but the good news is there's a lot to learn from those that have studied it, from those that support others along it, and most of all, from those who have actually travelled it.